So why do Christians suffer? It's a question that might seem strange to us here in the West because we enjoy religious freedom, but in other parts of the world, our brothers and sisters in the faith suffer terribly for their convictions about Jesus Christ. We're going to look at some of the scriptures today that tell us about why that is and why suffering is actually normal for the faith and not suffering as we do here in the West is actually something of an anomaly. So we're going to look at some scriptures that will help us understand those things with a view to understanding how we might respond and react and help here in the West. Hear these words from the book of Revelation. The saints, the martyred saints, ask this question: how long, sovereign Lord, holy and true, until you judge the inhabitants of the earth and avenge our blood? Then each of them was given a white robe, and they were told to wait a little longer until the full number of their fellow servants, their brothers and sisters, were killed just as they had been. Friends, suffering is part of the Christian faith. We suffer in the name of Jesus, and we suffer for the name of Jesus. And until that day comes where Christ redeems all of the dead who've died in their faith, we sing praise in hope and trust to God. And won't you join me in singing? And pray with me. Our Heavenly Father, open your book to us. Open the words of truth that we might hear your word and understand it and obey it in love and faithfulness. Send your Holy Spirit upon us that we might be so inspired by what we hear, both read and proclaimed, that we might once again be revived in our faith, remembering our brothers and sisters who suffer and praying passionately and fervently on their behalf. And we pray this in Christ's name. Amen.
Listen for these words from the book of Genesis, chapter 3, reading from verse 12 to 19. The man said, "The woman who you gave to be with me, she gave me fruit from the tree, and I ate." Then the Lord said to the woman, "What is this that you have done?" The woman said, "The serpent tricked me, and I ate." The Lord God said to the serpent, "Because you have done this, cursed are you among all animals and among all wild creatures. Upon your belly you shall go, and dust you shall eat all the days of your life. I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. He will strike your head, and you will strike his heel. To the woman he said, I will greatly increase your pangs in childbirth. In pain you shall bring forth children, yet your desire shall be for your husband, and he shall rule over you. And to the man he said, because you have listened to the voice of your wife and have eaten of the tree about which I commanded you, you shall not eat of it. Cursed is the ground because of you. In toil you shall eat it for all the days of your life. Thorns and thistles will bring forth for you, and you shall eat the plants of the field. By the sweat of your face you shall eat bread until you return to the ground. For out of it you were taken, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. Our second reading is from 1 Peter, reading from chapter 4, verses 12 to 19. Beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery ordeal that is taking place among you to test you, as though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice in so far as you are sharing Christ's sufferings, so that you may also be glad and shout for joy when his glory is revealed. If you are reviled for the name of Christ, you are blessed, because the Spirit of glory, which is the Spirit of God, is resting on you. But let none of you suffer as a murderer, a thief, a criminal, or even a mischief maker. Yet, if any of you suffers as a Christian, do not consider it a disgrace, but glorify God, because you will hear this name. For the time has come for judgment to begin with the household of God. If it begins with us, what will be the end for those who do not obey the gospel of God? And if it is hard for the righteous to be saved, what will become of the ungodly sinners? Therefore, let those sufferings be in accordance with God's will, entrust themselves to the faithful Creator while continuing to do good. Amen.
I remember the first time I heard stories about Christians suffering for their faith. It was in the first century where the Romans arrested them and put them in the Colosseum, and they were eaten by lions. They were attacked by wild beasts and literally ripped to pieces. Either that or they were sent in as victims before the gladiators, and they were hacked to bits. And over again you hear these stories about Christians who were suffering. The Emperor Nero had a particular reputation for being cruel to Christians, and many of them were crucified as Jesus was. Some were lit up as human torches and burnt to death. And the list goes on and on. The Apostle Paul also suffered for his faith. Originally in the book of Acts, you read that Paul, whose name was originally Saul, was a Jewish Pharisee, passionate about the faith. And he took it upon himself to see that the Christian church, young and infantile in its size and its maturity, he arrested people, had them thrown in prison, had them tortured, had them put to death, all in an effort to silence and stamp out the witness of Jesus Christ. But even Saul, who when he was converted became the Apostle Paul, he too suffered for his faith. He suffered in the same way that the people who had formerly suffered under him. He was arrested, he was beaten with rods, he was given the 40 stripes, which is a lashing with a big whip. He was imprisoned, he was probably tortured, suffering all kinds of deprivation for the name of Jesus. And the more you read Scripture, the more you realize that suffering and Christianity, or even suffering and faith in God, because the Jews suffered as well before the coming of Christ, they seem to go together, hand in hand, as one thing, two parts of the same whole. Paul writes in the book of Hebrews about the saints who came before us. He said some were tortured. Some had a trial of mockings and scourgings and of chains and imprisonment. They were stoned. They were sawn in two. They were tempted. They were slain with the sword. They wandered about in sheepskins and goatskins, being destitute, afflicted, and tormented. You read these stories and you wonder, what is going on here? What is going on with all this suffering? That's the first question that comes to mind. The second thing is you think about, well, I'm sure glad those things aren't happening today. I'm sure glad that the blood of the martyrs who came before me became the seed of the church that is today. I'm so glad that Christians don't suffer anymore, because I certainly don't suffer for my faith. I don't worry about people arresting me or stoning me or sawing me or my family in two pieces. I don't worry about these things. But would it surprise you to learn that there were more Christians who were martyred for their faith in the 20th century than there were in the other 19 centuries combined? That Christians are still dying for their faith all around the world. And I'll talk a little bit more about where they're dying and why they're dying in just a minute. Now, what I want to do before I get into this is show you a video, because there's an organization called Open Doors that is celebrating, I believe, its 50th anniversary in 2018, and their whole ministry is reaching out to the persecuted church around the world, and they've prepared this video that I want to share with you today. So let's go there now, and we'll have a look-see.
What would you do if your faith put you in danger? If it meant facing insults and abuse, not getting a job or education, being assaulted, imprisoned, even killed? Hundreds of millions of Christians live in countries where choosing to follow Jesus means danger and persecution. And these are the five countries where their faith costs the most. Number 5, Pakistan. Where Christians can be falsely accused of blasphemy. Christians are denied education and work opportunities. Churches are bombed. Christians are jailed on false charges. But Pakistani Christians are determined to meet to worship. Number 4, Libya. Where there are only some 150 Libyan Christians. Churches for Libyans are forbidden. Christian migrants are targets, executed by militants or sold into slavery. But Libyans are coming to Christ through TV, radio, and web. Number 3, Somalia, where Christians can be killed on the spot. All citizens are assumed to be Muslims. Militant groups want to eradicate all Christians. Owning a Bible can mean instant execution. But Christians meet in secret, and many Muslims seek Christ. Number 2, Afghanistan, where Christians have to hide even after death. Islamic extremism is everywhere. Christians are buried as Muslims because their relatives would be punished. But people still meet Christ in dreams. Number 1, North Korea, where leaders are worshipped like gods. There is no freedom. People live under constant surveillance. 50 to 70,000 Christians are imprisoned. But in prisons and safe houses, North Koreans are coming to Christ. Open Doors exists to strengthen and support persecuted Christians, wherever they are and for as long as they need it. Through the gifts and prayers of Open Door supporters, our global underground networks are able to reach millions of Christians with food and medicine, spiritual care, smuggled Bibles and Christian books, training and legal advice. Homes are rebuilt, lives are rescued, churches restored. For over 60 years, Open Doors has stood with Christians whose faith puts them in danger, who dare to share Jesus no matter the cost. Because as Christians, we are family, one body, one church. And when your family is in danger, there's only really one question to ask. What will you do?
You hear these stories, and as I said, it's almost too hard to believe. And what those who speak about the persecuted church find is that people have one of two reactions. One is that they just shut themselves off from the stories, either because they're too incredible to be believed or they're too painful to understand. The other reaction, though, is that people are cut to the heart and they ask themselves, what can we do? And you heard the story there, pray and give and share, and I'll talk a bit more about that in a minute. But before I do that, what I want to do is look back into the scriptures to give us an understanding of why faith, particularly Christian faith, and suffering seem to go hand in hand. Now, you'll remember the story of Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, how they sinned against God. They fell victim to the temptations of the serpent, and they were thrown out of the garden. And what happened is that God put enmity between the woman and the snake, that God increased the labor pains of the woman, and he consigned the man to working by the sweat of his brow to fight against the earth in such a way that he could bring food and grain for himself. And what that means is that we're at war with God because we've been cast out of the garden. We're at war with creation because creation is constantly threatening to undo us, even now with this pandemic. And thirdly, is that we're at war with one another. Now, whether you subscribe to this way of understanding reality or not, we don't have to think too hard about the fact that we all live with this sense deep in our hearts that things are not as they ought to be. We look around at creation and we see the polar ice caps melting and this mass extinction and, of course, the pandemic. We look at politics and government and we think, oh my goodness, what's going to happen next? We look at our disagreements with one another, with our neighbors, and even within our own families, and we recognize this yearning in our hearts. It's a haunting memory of the Garden of Eden, which tells us there is a way things ought to be, and then there's this discrepancy, this existential angst, where we recognize that things aren't that way, and they ought to be different. Now, we're all familiar with that, but what happened as a result of the being cast out of the garden was that God set people on a new trajectory in life. We were created to be in perfect fellowship with one another and with God in the garden, and that didn't work out. Now, the good news is that God didn't leave us in that estranged state, that we needn't be at war with God or with one another or with the creation, that God first sent the nation of Israel to serve as a light to the nations, a light to the Gentiles, a way of God demonstrating how things are supposed to be. God created this holy nation, this community that was to serve as a witness to all the world about what God intends for all of humanity. Laterally, He sent His Son, Jesus Christ, whom is the foundation and the Savior of our church. And Christ's work, this is obviously a review, was to mend that breach, that Christ gave Himself over to God, that God's justice was carried out in the person and the body of Jesus, and that by His death, our sins were forgiven. That we are restored in our relationship with God, that we are brought back together, that we needn't be at war with God, that we needn't be at war with the creation, nor with one another. Two trajectories. One is one of light and life, and the other is one of darkness and death. Now, what this does is it creates a new kind of warfare. It creates a sense of one trajectory that says, I'm my own person. I can do what I want. I can make my own decisions, irrespective of what anyone else says. There is a way that seems right to a man, but in the end it leads to death. The alternative is the pathway of light and life, and that is to come back to God. It's to find our way back to the garden by following the way and the truth and the life, who is Jesus Christ. That Christ beckons us, that Christ woos us, that Christ sends the Holy Spirit to enliven our hearts and fire our imagination and kindle our love for God. to bring us back to that state of perfection in which we were created. And what that means is that there's two trajectories, there's two pathways in life, and they are at odds with one another. And the reason that they're at odds with one another is because the pathway of light and life begins with our confession. It begins with our admission of our own fault. It begins with our confession of our sins. It begins with the recognition that, yes, I'm a descendant of Adam and Eve, and I am just as problematized, if you want to use that word, by their decisions as I am by my own, and that I am at odds with God, and I don't want to be that way anymore. And so when we confess our sins, we are forgiven and made new. We are transformed. We are made into new people. We are put on that pathway of light and life. But that's a cost to pay that many people don't want to pay. And they get angry at God, whether they say it in those terms or not, they get angry at God because they insist on their own way in life. They insist on having their own way. Jesus talked about this when he said, the light has come into the world in John chapter 3 and verse 19. It says, the light has come into the world, but men love darkness more than light because their deeds were evil. They love darkness more than light because their deeds were evil. That's those two paths that Christ has called us away from one path and onto this path of life, but that some prefer to remain in that darkness. Now, what that does is it creates a warfare between these two people, darkness and light. The people in darkness can't fight against God. God is invisible. God is a spirit and has no body. There's nothing they can do to hurt or harm God, but they can certainly hurt and harm God's messengers. They can abuse those who testify to the light. Not people who are the light, but people who point to the light by virtue of their life and lifestyle. They can arrest those people. They can beat them. They can burn their churches to the ground. They can deny them building privileges to build churches. They can deny them the privilege of meeting together. They can silence people by either throwing them deep into prisons in the bowels of the earth or simply killing them. They can deprive them of everything needed for life. Again, all in an effort to silence that witness, to say, no, my way is the right way. People are unwilling to pay that price of confession because they fear God and because there is a measure of pride that denies that they are steeped in darkness and evil deeds. Pride and fear keep people from coming to the light, and those who are in the light then become threatening to those who are in darkness. Now, this is the root of persecution. This is where it all comes from, because people in darkness don't like people in light because their deeds are evil. Now, it's sort of, when we compare that sort of experience with here in the West, if you think about a candle, well, we hold a candle of our testimony here in the West where religious freedom is preserved. And it's like holding a candle out on a sunny day. The candle is just as bright as it is in the darkness, but you can't see it. But when it's in the darkness, a candle is really bright. Now, both candles are easy to snuff out. But the one that's in the darkness is so much easier to see and so much more vulnerable because it's being seen. We ought not to be surprised about persecution. As I said earlier, persecution seems to just go along with the faith. Jesus himself warned us in John chapter 15 when he said, "If the world hates you, you know that it hated me before it hated you. If they persecuted me, they will also persecute you." We can never forget, friends, that we follow a crucified Savior. We don't follow an emperor or a prime minister or a president. We don't follow the richest man on Wall Street. We don't follow a warrior. we follow one who, in the eyes of the world, suffered an ignominious and meaningless death. So much so that Paul writes in the first chapter of 1 Corinthians, he says, God has used what is foolish to shame the wise, and he's used what's weak to shame the strong. Friends, we ought not to be surprised about persecution. We follow one who was persecuted and put to death, and we should expect no different. And Peter counsels the early church there. He says, Beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery ordeal that is taking place among you to test you, as though something strange were happening to you. If any of you suffers as a Christian, do not consider it a disgrace, but glorify God because you bear the name. In other words, don't complain about the suffering. Don't feel surprised about the suffering. We ought to understand that this is part of the deal because we follow a crucified God. And Peter paints it in these terms. He says, it's a fiery ordeal. In other words, it's purposeful. That God is, in the same way that a smith would refine gold or silver in a furnace to burn out the impurities, so God is doing the same with us, that our faith might be proved worthy and strong, that it might be strengthened rather than weakened, that God is at work in the midst of persecution, making his church strong. It's easier for some than for others. It's not easy being a Christian, no doubt, and no easier than it would be to stand the smell inside Noah's Ark, but the alternative is so awful that it's hardly worth thinking about. Now, I sometimes step back and when I hear these stories of people suffering and being persecuted in other countries, and I ask myself, how would I stand up amidst the torturer's instruments? And I hope that I never come to that day. But I suspect that the reason people are able to withstand that punishment is because taking up the cross of Christ, believing in Jesus, is not something that we do in the same way that we would affiliate ourselves with the Labor Party or the Conservative Party, or like taking up being a fan of a particular football team. When we come to Christ, we are forgiven and transformed and made ontologically different. It means our being is changed. It's not just an idea that we accept. It's not just a system of beliefs that we accept intellectually. It's a personal, complete transformation. That we become someone different than we were before. And when those who are persecuted are urged to recant their faith and to give it up, they can't do it. Because it's not like simply saying, right, I'll vote Labor this time round. It's like saying, I would have to deny myself if I were to deny Christ, because he and I have become one in my baptism. I've been united with Christ, and to deny Christ would be to deny myself. If I were to deny Christ, I would cease to exist. My being would no longer exist. And so, no, it's not as if I don't want to recant under this torture. It's that I can't. I can't do it. Now, I trust that the Holy Spirit would strengthen someone in that position. I don't think I could do that right now, but I trust that God would strengthen me in the moment. Another organization, Release International, it was begun by a pastor named Richard Vermbrand, and the most incredible thing that he discovered under torture was not that his hatred for his torturers grew, but rather his love for them. That the more they beat him, the more they imprisoned him, the more he loved them. Now that's a transformation that you cannot fathom. How someone who is being so poorly treated could then love his jailers and love the ones who were persecuting him. How does that happen? Well, that happens because the Holy Spirit moves in your hearts in such a way that the love of Christ comes through you. Remember what Jesus said when he was literally, as he was being nailed to the cross, he says, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. He forgave them, and he loved them on the spot. This is the transformation that happens amidst persecution, that people are transformed by the fiery ordeal of persecution, and they are purified in those fires. Not an easy thing to endure. Now, as I said, here in the West, we don't suffer for our faith. Although I believe that there still is a war going on against the church. The devil has a perpetual aim of pulling people away from God, of driving them down that pathway of darkness, and stopping that witness of God. Historically, all through the life of the church, the means of doing that has been through violence and bloodshed. That people have fought against the witness of the church, and they've tried to kill people in prison and torture, etc., in an effort to stamp out that witness. And in some place, they've been very effective at doing that. But here in Britain, and in America, in the West, we live in a new kind of world. We live with a measure of prosperity that is unimaginable for the rest of the world, unimaginable for people in the two-thirds world, unimaginable even for kings of 100 years ago. We have so much. We live in luxury. Our standard of living, our definition of poverty, would be unrecognizable even to members of our own country from 50 years ago. We have so much stuff and are so comfortable. And what that's done, a long story, I won't go into it right now, but what that's done is create a situation where God is optional. God is optional. You don't have to believe in God. Historically, God was so prevalent that you couldn't not believe in God. But here in the West, in Britain, it's very easy to not believe in God. It's because we live in a secular world in which God has become a private matter. And so Christians who have gone down that pathway of light and life have opted for God, while those who go down that pathway of darkness have opted not for God. But does that change the nature of who God is? Does God stop being God because someone says God doesn't exist? Does God become more God because someone says, I'll have God in my life? No. But the weapon that I believe the devil is using is apathy, that people are so overwhelmed, so buried in stuff, so bombarded by so many different ideas that they don't have the energy to think it through properly, and they become apathetic about God. We live in a strange world, and people say, why don't people come to church? And I say, well, it's not because people woke up and thought to themselves, I'll just have a lie-in this morning. I don't feel like going to church. People are not in that place any longer. They wake up on a Sunday morning and church is not even something that is on the list of options, because many people have simply never been to church because we've become so accustomed to this idea that it's normal not to believe in God, that church and worship and fellowship is just something that's not even considered. And I believe that that weapon against the church is as effective and perhaps even more effective at bringing attrition to the church than is violence and bloodshed. Some years ago, I was talking to my mentor in ministry, and he was talking about marital counseling. We do a little bit of that as ministers, and sometimes couples come to us who are at war with one another. And he said, John, I can always tell, almost without people saying anything, whether they're going to split up. He says, and it's not when they're angry. When they're angry at each other, there's still passion. There's love. There's emotion involved in the relationship. It's when they're apathetic that I know that the love has already died, when they don't care anymore. He says, that marriage is already dead. And I suggest to you the same is true today, that people have become so apathetic about God that that relationship is already severed. It's already so estranged that it's almost impossible to bring it back. Jesus said once that it's more difficult for a rich man to get into the kingdom than it is for a camel to go through the eye of the needle. And the disciples asked him, well, who then can be saved? And Jesus said, well, with man, this is impossible. But with God, all things are possible. And I believe that God is using persecution in the church elsewhere to revive and inspire and move people to faith. And I believe that God can and will and is using apathy in the same way. That God will, in his time and in his purposes and for his plan and for his glory, use that method, turn the devil's weapon against him, and use apathy as a way of bringing people into the church. Now, I don't know how that happens. With man, that's impossible. But with God, all things were possible. Because God yearns that all should be saved and that everyone should come into the knowledge of the Savior. Look for that in the coming years ahead. The church is not dying. The church is transforming. The church is changing into something else. The packaging may be getting thrown away, but something alive is at work in the church. And just as surely as the devil is using anger and violence against the church, God can take apathy and transform it into something beautiful as well. Either way, the church is being persecuted or it's being ignored. Now, I want to go back to that video where it says give and share and pray. Those are the things that we can do as Christians. We can give of our time and our money. We can share our resources with others, and we can also pray for others. And I'm going to go back to the video because the second half of it is a talk from Mark Hind, who is the Scotland representative for Open Doors. And he's going to talk to us about how important it is for us to pray on behalf of our brothers and sisters in other parts of the world.
What will you do? It's a really powerful question that challenges me every time I hear it. Just a little while ago, I read a letter from a pastor's wife in Syria. It was one of the most honest and raw letters I've ever read. And in it, she was describing how challenging it is to be a Christian in Syria and to be a church leader in Syria. She's saying that there are people being kidnapped and it's a very dangerous place to minister. And she says in the letter how they had a chance to leave the country when the war began and the challenges of all that was going on, as so many were leaving. But they felt God calling them to stay. And she said, God, okay, if you want me to stay, what do you want us to do? And she thought that God was going to ask them to do something really bold and big and courageous. But instead, she just sensed God's Spirit saying to her, are you willing to die for me? Such a challenging question. It took her quite a long time to really search her soul and pray and wait on God. But eventually she was able to say, God, yes, I'm willing to lay down my life for you and for the gospel and for the work here in Syria that we're doing. But then she felt God's Spirit prompt her again the following day to say, and what about your husband? Are you willing to lay him on that altar? This was a whole different level, and it took her a while again of soul searching and really praying and waiting on God. But eventually she was able to say, God, I lay my husband down. We're going to give you our lives here, if that's what it takes in Syria. And finally, the real challenge, the deepest challenge, came the following night. She was woken in the night and sensed God's Spirit saying to her, what about your children, your two children? And it took her and her husband several days as she shared with him this challenge that she felt in her soul. And after a few days of wrestling in their souls, they were able to kneel before God and tearfully say, God, please don't take our children. Please don't allow anything to happen to them. But even if the worst was to happen, we're still going to serve you here in Syria. We're still going to do your work, and we're willing to give our all for that work. And as she finished this letter, she talks about how they talk about heaven a lot. It was a beautiful letter, but she said right at the very end, she talks about all of this in Syria. And then she says, we don't know what's going to happen to us. Will you please pray for us? Will you please pray for us? I know that Pastor John is doing this series, and part of it is, why do we pray? And God's word tells us, doesn't it, that prayer is a powerful weapon. But if someone we've never met leading a church in Syria is asking us to pray for them, and I know that there are thousands and thousands of people all over the persecuted church who, when we turn up in their country as a team, we minister and we tell them there are people back home in Scotland who are praying for you, it breaks them. They are often overwhelmed, they can't understand, and just are so humbled by the fact that they're not forgotten, they're remembered. Brother Andrew, the founder of Open Doors, says that our prayers can go where we can't go. There are no borders, no prison walls, and no doors that are closed to us when we pray. One of the most powerful things that we can do in our lives is come before the God of heaven and ask him to change situations for people here on earth. And a large part of Open Doors ministry is doing exactly that, is providing resources to help brothers and sisters like you to pray for our persecuted family. And this morning I'm asking, will you consider committing to praying for them, getting behind them, encouraging them, spurring them on, supporting them? And if that's you today, then maybe you'd be willing to go to the Open Doors website and check out the prayer resources. Go to the resource section and click on prayer. There's some beautiful prayer resources, prayer videos. And you can sign up at the bottom of the page to an email that gets sent out regularly, which will encourage you to pray. But thank you for listening. Thank you for your time. May God really bless you.
Following on from Mark's call to prayer, I want to focus on those five countries that are the most dangerous places in the world to be Christians. And I want to invite you to join me when we say, Lord have mercy, Christ have mercy, Lord have mercy. And will you pray with me? O God, how we cry out for justice and ask, how long, O Lord, how long must your servants suffer? How long must your church languish in heartache, doubt, and fear? How long must these lambs be sacrificed to the evil one incarnate in those who hate the Lord? Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. O God, we lift up to you our brothers and sisters in Pakistan, where anti-blasphemy laws established by a militant Islamist regime are used as weapons to settle petty disputes between neighbors, and men and women are falsely accused of insulting the Prophet and are sentenced to prison and to suffering and to isolation. We pray for the body of Christ forced into the most demeaning tasks as second-class citizens, second-class humans, stunted and deprived of human decency. We pray especially for Christian women and girls who are most vulnerable to attack. Defend them and place your angels around them and uphold them in your strong hand. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Father, we pray for our brothers and sisters in Libya whose faith must be kept as a precious and dangerous secret. God, in a country where freedom of speech is a forbidden luxury, put words in the mouths of your saints, words of healing and hope, and forgiveness for their persecutors. As you prophesied, Lord, you have not come to bring peace but division, even amongst families and those who love one another. In Libya, families are torn apart, and those who love have become those who hate the most. O God, change hearts and minds, and lead others to the good news of Jesus' welcoming grace. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Saving God, we pray for your church in Somalia, a country ravished and devoured by locusts and one facing extreme famine and deprivation. Your little ones will be the first to suffer and will stand at the end of the bread lines and will starve to death without your provision. Their faith is a closely guarded secret and one they share at the risk of their lives. Lord, bring your law to that lawless and hate-filled land where fear and dread have taken hold in the desert and your children cry in the night. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Strong and mighty God, a tower of righteousness and salvation, we pray for your children in Afghanistan who have been called to suffer for the name of Jesus Christ. Their faith is purified in the furnace of affliction and persecution, and many perish, languishing in prisons and beneath the instruments of the torturer who knows no mercy. Send your holy angels, legions upon legions of them, to defend your church and deliver your saints. Let the spilling of their blood signal the beginning of revival and the conversions of many hearts. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. O God, who can change hearts and minds, we pray for your church in North Korea, where Christianity is synonymous with death and imprisonment, a land where whole families are wiped away from the face of the earth to die in starvation and cold, in a land where their humanity is stolen away from them. And yet the faithful continue to grow in courage and in strength. O God, defend your church from a dictator and a despot whose desire is for control of the mind itself, and a whole country is brainwashed into believing that a man is a god. O one true God, establish your reign in that upside-down nation. Let darkness become light, and the light drive away all darkness. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. O God, who converts hearts, who speaks in dreams and visions and miracles, O God, who can soften the hardest hearts, illuminate the darkest minds, and bring peace to the most demented souls, we pray for your church. O God, forgive us, for we are so negligent in prayer, so doubtful of your power, so afraid to speak, even in a country whose foundations are deeply rooted in the testimony of the saints who have come before us. O God, show us the way of salvation and strengthen our resolve to speak and to act, to give and to share, and most of all to pray impassioned and insistent prayers of deliverance for those who suffer in this age. Bless them all, even as they strive to follow the one who suffered and died, that we might have life and have it in abundance. This we pray, trusting in Jesus, who taught us to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, as we say farewell to one another today, I pray God's blessing on you today. I know some of the things that I've said and talked about today have been difficult to hear, and I pray that you will be amongst those whose hearts are cut to the quick, cut to the core in compassion for those who are suffering. Friends, our brothers and sisters, the body of Christ, with which we are joined as one is in agony. And I pray that you will feel that pain and that you will give and that you will share and that you will pray. You can find more information about Open Doors and other agencies that help the persecuted church in the details below, and I pray that you'll take that time to do that. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May God be kind and gracious to you. May he look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.